Paul says in Romans 10, 14 to 15, how then can they call on the one they have not believed in? And how can they believe in the one on whom they have not heard? And how can they hear without someone preaching to them? And how can they preach unless they are sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news. We continue in our celebration of Missions Month. And may these familiar words of Paul inspire us to be those who bear the good news. We, who have been touched by the gospel, have this wonderful task of making it known to others. And this evening, we have the privilege of honoring God, of whom this good news speaks of. Join me in prayer. Our loving Heavenly Father, it is always good to be in your sanctuary to worship and praise you for who you are and the mighty deeds that you have done. In your presence, Lord, is fullness of joy and gladness of heart. And all our troubles and burdens are lifted up in the light of your goodness and steadfast love for us. Forgive us, Lord, as in our unguarded moments when we fail to live up to our namesake of being called your children. Restore us in your righteousness and renew our spirits to becoming more like you, so that when people see or hear us, they would be inclined to listen to the gospel of your salvation and the amazing grace that you have in store for everyone who believes. Embolden us to proclaim your name and empower us to make disciples of all peoples and nations. For this is the reason for which we are saved, to be partners in the missional work of bringing the good news to the world and in advancing your kingdom in all the earth. This is our prayer, and we ask this in the mighty name of our Lord and Savior Jesus. Amen.
Our God's greatness is beyond measure. His power, his works demand and deserve all of our praises. So why don't we all rise as we worship our God for his grace and greatly to be praised.
Yeah. written by Frank Houghton at the height of missionary persecution. And as he reflected on Matthew 24, verse 14, to bear the torch of the gospel to all the nations, his heart was broken looking at the mission task ahead. So may this song encourage us to rise up and face the unfinished task to go to all the world and proclaim salvation in Jesus' name. Please join us as we sing in the familiar melody of the church's one foundation.
Oh.
Complacency to unfurl the good news until the whole world heals. You may all be seated.
Good evening, beloved. You can tell it's a very special month we have in Missions Month. First of all, we will have a series of four special preachers for the next Sundays, beginning with today. And he's a good friend of GCF. He's a pastor at large of GCF. And Pastor Coloy Peña will be formally introduced shortly. So that's one. Now, here's the other thing that makes this month special. There'll be special activities related to missions. You already heard the announcement for evangelism training. Please take advantage. And, because it's God's movement among us. A couple of months ago, this is the great time to announce it. We had a very successful high school camp, and I had the great privilege tonight of inviting over some of those who got baptized in that high school camp. There were 25, right? And we're going to pray with thanksgiving to God for them, and we praise the Lord for them. Could I invite them over here? All of you who were baptized in the high school camp, could you come over here and come up with the quickness that high school you are known for? Yes, see, raving fans out there. College also, and college, okay. College and high school, come over here, yes. Can you guys see how inspired the church is just to realize that he saved you guys and you got baptized? So if you total the college and high school baptism, there were 65. Can you imagine that? 65 new GCFers. And Lord, help us. We need to be able to disciple each of you until you disciple others too. So we're here today to give glory to God, to appreciate those two. Did you recognize that it takes very good-looking people to become GCF pastors? Those two over there, Doug's and JP, we're here to thank God. I'm going to pray for them. Give glory to God and pray that we disciple them. But could you just raise your right hand towards them as a way of praying together with me, so we'll be praying together. Thank God for all of you. Let's pray. Father, thank you for these gifts of life. You gave them life. You saved them. And then, Lord, they publicly declared to everyone, we're Christians now. When they were baptized in the high school and college camps. Thank you, Lord. We are here to give you glory. We are here to say that it was you who called them sovereignly. It was you, Lord, who put it in their hearts to be baptized. Now, Lord, help us. Part of this prayer is not just for them and their growth spiritually. It is, Father, but part of this prayer is to pray that we as a church should not be negligent, but be able to disciple them well, to follow them up well, to disciple them until they also disciple others, to disciple them until they start witnessing and then following up and discipling, to disciple them until they start serving, Lord, until they start leading. Thank you for these young lives. Thank you, Lord, that by your grace, purely by your grace, you keep calling the young people. And therefore, Lord, you're ensuring that this church will continue to live on, because it isn't just the elderly, the mature, the middle age, even the couples that you're saving, but the very young, the high school and college. And they will be the next leaders, the next disciples, the next witnesses for this church. Father, thank you for them, and we pray that you grow them in the faith as they're trained in your word. Help them grow with us here at Green Hills Christian Fellowship. We give you glory. We give you thanksgiving. We honor you, Father, in Jesus' name. And all God's people say, Amen, amen. Let's give them another round of applause, please. God bless you guys. We'll see you in every youth service and in every Sunday service. Praise the Lord. I have one more announcement. That's my only role tonight, to really announce these things. But it gives me such great joy to announce what you've just heard. And now this one. The highlight of Missions Month is to launch our next church plant, which is called GCF Ozames. Could you kindly pull out this green thing inside your bulletins? GCF Ozames is located in Mindanao. It's the farthest church plant we've ever had. And my dear friends, it is going to be a work of God. You know, from the words of our benefactors who are connected to the most powerful ruling family there, the Christians among them, they said, Pastor, there's a lot of darkness in that place. There's a lot of drugs. There's a lot of crime. And we need the gospel there. And we couldn't agree more. So, beloved, like we always do when we launch a church, we'll have a shower of blessings. The amounts are here. And the missions ministry has told us, the instructions are, they said, we encourage donation in cash and check. And I was asked the first time I announced this, Pastor, which one? The green one or the black one? Either. But you just write there, GCF Ozames, if God lays it on your heart. There's no compulsion dito. This is purely voluntary. By the way, if you're a guest, please do not feel obligated. This giving is for members of the church, but we will not also stop you should God inspire you to give. Now, you must be asking, why do they not want in kind? Because they used to take it in kind because of the distance. It will cost more to transport, for example, one steel cabinet. It will be very expensive to transport it all the way to Mindanao. So if God lays it on your heart, over and above your regular offering, will you please give? Thank you. In a short while, we'll have the offering, so may the Lord put it in your heart. God bless you, and good night.
Philippians 4:19 says, and my God will meet all your needs according to his glorious riches in Christ Jesus. May this act of worship and stewardship reflect our thanks to our God who meets all our needs. In so doing, may we also encourage you to give in support of missions as well. So let us pray. Lord God, with naked we came into the world and we can't take anything with us when we leave. Bestow on us an attitude of thanksgiving and contentment and guide us to be good stewards of your resources. Accept our humble gifts and offerings and use them for whatever purpose you have for them. And that your name be glorified. Bless these gifts and the giver, and continue to shine your face upon everyone here tonight, even as we look forward to another blessed week ahead of us. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Is hungry and prays for something she can eat. A single mom doing all she can finds herself out on the street. Will we see the need and hear their cries? Look at their watch and just walk on by. Will we stop and take the time to be Jesus in their life? We need to be Jesus, Jesus, Jesus.
Jesus came with a message that would change the way we live. He showed us all by example what the heart of heaven is. He saw our need and he heard our cry. He loved us so much that he gave his life. He taught us by his sacrifice that we should live a life.
We need to be lambs that roar. We need to be eagles that soar. We need to be salt. To the world, to take love into the streets, be willing to turn the other cheek. We need to be strong,
we need to be weak,
we need to be Jesus,
Jesus to the world.
We can talk and talk about what is wrong, but that won't change one thing at all. We must take God's love where the hurting live. That's what Jesus
needs. Lambs that roar, Jesus to the world.
We need to be
lambs that roar. We need to be eagles that soar. We need to be salt. We need to be light. We need to be Jesus to the world.
We need to take
love into the streets. Be willing to tell the other cheek. We need to be strong.
We need to be weak.
We need to be Jesus.
Jesus to the world.
Our scripture passage for tonight is found in Psalm 67, verses 1 to 7. May I request all of us to please rise and also to participate in the reading of God's word. May God be gracious to us and bless us and make his face to shine on us, so that your ways may be known on earth, your salvation among all nations. May the nations be glad and sing for joy, for you rule the peoples with equity and guide the nations of the earth. The land yields its harvest, God, our God. Blesses us. May God bless us still so that all the ends of the earth will fear him. Blessed is the reading of God's word. His name is most worthy of all. You may all be seated. It is my privilege tonight to introduce to you our special speaker. Reverend Carlos Peña is the founder of Life Change Fellowship, a group of multi-ethnic house churches that started in Singapore. He is a lecturer at East Asia School of Theology, the International Graduate School of Leadership counterpart in Singapore. Pastor Carlos is also consulting with FEBC International. He is engaged in cross-cultural training of new missionaries as well as in significant expository preaching ministry. Let us all welcome Pastor Carlos Peña.
A warm good evening. Right. It's good to be here, and it's good to be at this final service. It's a great joy for me to get to this place because I'm no longer used to preaching so much in my life on one given day. But it is a joy always to open God's Word. And I thank Pastor Eric, Pastor Larry for agreeing to my proposal to invite me in order to preach. And that's what it is. I said, Pastor Eric, I'll be in town. Would you like to have me invited to your pulpit? And so it's a great joy to be here. The last time I was here was in 2011, so that's 5 years ago. And that should be okay, right? You listen to this guy every 5 years. That should be enough. At any rate, it is a joy. Sometimes I feel like whenever I'm at GCF and I hear the singing, incredible, powerful, uplifting singing, I feel like, why did I even think about house churches where we can't sing? If ever we sing, it's just a small group. You know, let's just close that down and become like GCF in Singapore. And maybe we should be doing that with a wink, according to Pastor Larry. Anyway, I'm glad to be back. And I hope that it will not take another 5 years before I come. Okay, now, I want to begin by a statement made by Martin Luther King. Martin Luther King Jr., of course, he is the one who put into the forefront racial discrimination in the United States of America. Martin Luther King had this to say: "The most segregated hour on planet Earth is 11 o'clock in the morning, Sundays." Now, when you think about that, that is actually about the church. It is because it is church time that America becomes so segregated. Now, you might think that was just an observation. It is an indictment against the Church of God. In other words, the church has become the world's number one division maker, in the U.S., at least. And it is true that even today, here in our country, even elsewhere around the world, we divide the church by race. We divide the church by language. We divide the church by age. We divide the church by styles of worship. We divide the church according to whatever preference we like. And we belong to that group that makes us feel really good, isn't it? The church has become lost among a myriad of pigeonholes. And now it is trying to take its cue from the trendiest of programs around, or the most fashionable method of doing church. Now, I may offend some of you. That's not my intention. My intention is to introduce to you Psalm 67. Because Psalm 67 brings us back to simple, happy, purposeful, and effective life as a community of faith. In fact, Psalm 67, it's the plot of the story of the church from beginning to end. And therefore, it is like a map where it sketches for us an adventure from beginning to end. And it is much clearer than any Uber taxi that you try to get, clearer than Google Maps, clearer than the Waze app could ever devise. So it is a journey to the destiny as a faith community following hard after our Lord Jesus Christ. And when we look at this thing, the journey starts with prayer. And it is this prayer that somehow occasions an encounter with the nations. And when that encounter happens, it leads towards wonder. So the journey begins at home, right here at GCF. It begins right here in near Ortigas. It begins right here where you are at home. And it sees the people of God on their knees. And so we start with this community in prayer. And it starts with verse 1, "May God be gracious to us and bless us and make his face to shine on us." When you go down to verse 6, it says, "The land yields its harvest. God our God blesses us. May God bless us still." Now some of you might think, you know, that first verse sounds familiar. And it's familiar because many of us know the Lutkin's benediction, or the sevenfold amen. You know, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious. You know that song? It's a benediction. It comes from Numbers chapter 6. where God commanded Aaron, the priest, to pronounce this blessing to his people as a sign that God is a God of promise and he seeks to bless his people. And Aaron, the priest, pronounces it on the community of faith as a promise from God. But in Psalm 67, it's not a pronouncement. What it is a prayer. In other words, it's a prayer for God to fulfill his promise of blessing. Now, there are three short prayers, but it's incredibly loaded with theology. First of all, it is a humble prayer. May God be gracious to us. Of course, GCFers, what's the G for? Green Hills. I thought it was grace. Never mind. To be gracious. To be gracious carries the idea, of course, of unmerited favor, and we all know that. It means that a superior being condescends, stoops, and bends towards the recipient in order to provide a favor for that recipient. And that is what we all are in a position before God. We are in need of his grace, and it is a posture, incredibly, a posture of dependence. In other words, when we come to God, we cannot come to God saying, God, I am entitled. God, I am strong. God, I am in control. It comes to God in weakness. It comes to God with nothing to boast, nothing to give back, nothing at all except to stand in the grace and mercy of God. It's a humble prayer, and that is where all prayer ought to begin. But it is also a habitual prayer, as you see. Lord, bless us. In fact, if you look at that verse in verse 6 and 7, not only bless us, in fact, you have blessed us. It says, the land yields its harvest. God, our God, blesses us. May God bless us still. So it's not even just, Lord, bless us. Oh, you blessed us. But we need more blessing. Oh, my goodness. This is such an audacious request, isn't it? I mean, sometimes when I read God's word, I say to myself, tama pala ang prosperity gospel. Ito, bless us. Oh, you blessed us. Oh, can you bless us still? We want some more. See, a prayer blessing demonstrates what? A penchant for abundance. It's habitual because it is our knee-jerk reaction. How many of you prayed today? Maybe you prayed for your children, you were having grace, or you were eating a meal and you began to pray. You were here in church, you began to pray. How many of you used the word bless or blessing, correct? I mean, most of us would pray, say, Lord, would you please bless this person? Lord, please bless my children. Lord, please bless my family. I mean, of all prayers, I think, of all the words that God has heard, the number one word he has heard in heaven is bless. I mean, we love that word. But what is it to me to ask God for his blessing? It is indeed audacious. Because the word means to ask God for everything that makes for happiness. It is to ask God for everything that satisfies, everything that is good, everything that is full, not withholding anything, and it's according to his covenant promises to Abraham. When you go down to Psalm 66, or the previous chapter, it says, this blessing includes fields and flocks. You know what that means? Property. And if you go to Psalm 115, the blessings include success in every undertaking. You know what that means? Property, income, everything you do, you get promoted. Oh my goodness, God, bless me, please. Promote me. Give me more income. Give me more property, assets. But be careful if you become a politician. Salen. Now, Deuteronomy 28, verses 1 and 2 says this. And it all gets summed up in this statement by Moses. If you will diligently obey the Lord your God, being careful to do all his commandments, the Lord your God will set you high above all the nations of the earth. Now listen. And all these blessings shall come upon you. Did you hear that? All these blessings shall come upon you if you will obey the Lord your God. And so it brings us to the third request in this first verse. What does it say? And what is that thing? In my monitor, you don't see it. Good. The third is an honorable prayer. And it says this: may God make his face shine on us. Now, we've heard that prayer before. Lord, make your face shine on me. What is a shining face? For anyone to have a shining face means the face is oily. No, it's not. In the Bible, when you have a shining face, it's an expression of inward delight, an expression of inward pleasure. In other words, there's something going on in your life, and whatever that event, whatever that occasion that makes your face smile, that's a shining face. And so you might have a son, a daughter, just graduated from college, maybe with honors, and it puts a smile on your face as a parent. Maybe you just gave birth to an infant. That doesn't put a smile on your face at first, but it does later on, doesn't it? Right? It puts a smile on your husband's face, definitely. Right? It's something good that happens when you fall in love and that person says, yes. Oh, dear. Your face shines like it never has. So I look at these old husbands. Their face is no longer shining. How come? In other words, a shining face is one who's really happy inside. Two men actually reported to their community that their rabbi found treasure, unearthed treasure. And they reported that to the Jewish community. And the community said, well, how do you know? What's your proof that our rabbi actually found some treasure? And they said, it's easy. His face is shining. You have shining face here? You got some blessing. You got to give osamis. Now, I can do these things because I'm not from GCF. So, to make one's face shine towards another person is another thing. For one to have the face shine means there's something delighting that person deep within. But when you say a face is shining towards another person, it means that person is ready to provide favor to that person. And so the opposite of God's shining face is what? If God's face is not shining, it is hidden. And in the Bible, there are occasions when God's face is hidden from his people. And when God's face is hidden from his people, guess what? His people are in mortal danger when God hides his face. The question for you and me, how do we put a smile on God's face? Is that a fair question? Do you want to put a smile on God's face? Do you want God's face to shine on you? I believe we can do that. And what it requires is simple. It is a predisposition to obedience. It's not actual obedience yet, but he knows in your heart that you are asking to be blessed 100-fold, if not 1,000-fold, because he sees your heart ready to do his will. Look at the Bible. Psalm 119, verses 132, 134. The psalmist declares, turn to me and be gracious to me after your manner with those who love your name. Establish my footsteps in your word. Do not let any iniquity have dominion over me. Redeem me from the oppression of man, that I may keep thy precepts. Make your face shine upon your servant, and teach me your statutes. Did you hear the same phrase? Make your face shine upon your servant. And then around that phrase are these other phrases. For example, establish my footsteps in your word. And then it says, that I may keep thy precepts. And then it says, that I may be taught thy statutes. In other words, as I keep in alignment with the word of God, his face begins to shine upon me. So what do we learn about this very simple, short prayer? God, be gracious, bless us, make your face shine upon us. Prayer, brothers and sisters. It is the appointed means, God's appointed means to bringing grace upon our lives and glory to himself. You know, when you look at that first verse, after the verse, there's this cryptic word, selah. You see that in your Bibles? Selah, after the first word. And you wonder, you scratch your head, what does that word mean? Actually, nobody knows what the word means. But many have suggested that Selah in Hebrew means pause, stop, reflect, be still. It is a time after uttering that prayer, after singing that prayer, because it's a psalm, stop. Now, could you imagine singing and then suddenly you stop? I mean, we haven't heard such a song, but here, stop, pause, take time to think, meditate on what you just prayed. Our desert fathers have coined a word for it. It's called hesychastic prayer. Never mind. But it is to be still. It is to be still, to keep meditating on those words until they become a prayer of and from the heart. And for the desert fathers, the heart is the seat of the entire and whole being. The heart is the seat of one's cognition, one's emotion, and one's volition. And so when the intellect and the feelings and the desire to do and will come together after praying that prayer, then you have it. This is it. It all becomes one. You know, almost 5 years ago, my wife and I were waiting nervously for her diagnosis on her biopsy. And when the doctor dropped the C word, I felt like my whole world had collapsed on me, and I was not even the one who was sick. It was my wife. But I remember distinctly my knee-jerk response to that statement, "You've got C, you've got cancer," was this silent prayer deep in me and said, "Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy." And as I thought about that and the experience I had in that prayer, as I did a Selah, I realized it's the place where all of life begins. When the realization hits hard that I am not in control of my life, that I am not the captain of my soul, nor am I entitled to anything that is good in this life, it occurred to me, Lord, have mercy, and that is actually where all of life truly begins. And unless all of us come to the same place where we understand it is all by grace and His mercy, we will never experience life as God has designed it to be. We are incredibly dependent on His grace. But after a time of thinking through and praying through what had happened to my wife, our prayers began to change from "Lord, have mercy" to "Lord, thy will be done. Thy will be done." And later on, facing the prospects of more and more treatment, still the Lord brought us deeper into His heart, and He taught us how to pray an even deeper prayer. From "Lord, have mercy" to "Lord, thy will be done" to "Lord, glorify your name no matter what." That first verse is the same thing. You start with, "Lord, have mercy. I stand in the need of your grace. May God be gracious upon us." And it moves from "bless us," because it's a promise of God. "Lord, I will be done. Bless us," because that's your will. That's your promise for us. And then it moves to a shining face, which means glory to God. We give glory to Him. And that's what life truly is all about. So the psalmist here in the first verse teaches us not only what to pray, how to pray, but he moves on. So now the question, why do we pray this prayer even? That is a prayer of blessing. And we move to the second point. It's because of this occasion of an encounter. When we pray for blessing, something happens. There is a motivation for asking God for blessings. Verse 2 says, "So that your ways may be known on earth, your salvation may be known among all nations." Then you look at verse 7, "So that all the ends of the earth will fear Him." Now, we understand better, don't we, why we can utter such an audacious blessing request. It is the motive behind that prayer for blessing. You see, the motive reaches all the way down to a covenant that God had made to Abraham. Remember? Genesis 12, Genesis 15, and 17. God chose Abraham, and He said, move out of Ur of the Chaldees to the land that I will show you. And Abraham, I'm going to bless you. I'm going to make you a nation. You're going to be a father of many nations, and you will be a blessing, isn't it? That's God's covenant to Abraham and to the people of Israel. This is God's promise and plan. But now we can read the fine print better. You see, the word no, you know, God's way may be known on the earth. His salvation may be known among all nations. What's that word no? You see, that word no is more than just an intellectual exercise. It is the word that could be translated, as far as I'm concerned, as encounter. You see, to know is to encounter. To know is to learn via the many senses that God has given us. By sight, by hearing, by taste, by touch, by our minds, we know because we encounter things around us. In fact, the Hebrew way of describing the very physical and intimate exchange between husband and wife is this euphemistic, he knew her. In the Bible, in the Old Testament, instead of going through the vivid details of the sexual act, the author euphemistically simply says, he knew her. Knowledge has certain levels. In fact, here, the first level would be attention, so that your ways may be known on earth. All the people of the world, mankind, will have the opportunity to know that there is a God, and that this God is one who can be known through his creation and through his revelation. In fact, Isaiah and the prophet Habakkuk prophesied, predicted that this will take place. The knowledge of God, the earth will be filled with the knowledge of the Lord as the waters cover the sea. Every person in this planet, past, present, and future, every person is born with the understanding that there is a God, because God sets eternity in every person's heart. And therefore, if there are people that say, you're crazy, there is no God, if they deny that the existence of God, what it means is they're simply denying the truth in their heart. Mankind will know. Mankind knows there is a God who can be known on this earth. The second level of encounter is invitation. Your salvation may be known among all the nations. This is actually an invitation to salvation among all the nations. And so here is the original Great Commission in the Old Testament. All nations will learn about God's gift of salvation. And then it moves on to the third level, which is conversion. In verse 7, the very last verse simply says, so that all the ends of the earth will fear him. In other words, the longed-for outcome in this encounter is the fear of God. Of course, the question is, Pastor, what does that mean? The fear of God? Takot sa Diyos? Bawat Pilipino may takot sa Diyos. But what does it mean? When you understand the concept of fear of God, especially in the Old Testament, the fear of God is actually the motivation towards righteous living. In other words, if people truly feared the God of Israel, there was a manifest change in the way they lived. It became a life that was now righteously lived before the God, the Lord of Israel. In other words, it's a radical reorientation of life to fear this God. It is the motivation that produces holiness. It is reverence and awe, certainly it is. But it is that kind of awe and fear and reverence that somehow produces a shift in one's total self. And that shift is the fear of God. So, if prayer is the launching pad of missions, right? Prayer is the launching pad of missions, then the fear of God is the landing point, isn't it? Let's pray. And as we pray, there's an encounter in the world. And we want the destiny to be the fear of God. It's the landing point. Now, the Bible tells us in Proverbs 1, verse 6, the fear of God is the beginning of wisdom. That's right. The fear of God is the beginning of wisdom. Have you ever asked the question, why? Why is the fear of God the beginning of wisdom? I mean, I can be wise without fearing God. I mean, there's lots of wise people in the world. They don't even know God, right? But why is it the beginning of wisdom? And I believe it's because of this. To fear God is the most basic, the most important, the most decisive action one has to make in life. It is the mother of all decisions. To fear God is the first, and all other decisions you make in life are secondary, and yet it flows out of that fundamental one, the fear of God. You see, God's ultimate purpose is not simply for people to believe in Jesus. God's ultimate agenda is for people's hearts to turn to Jesus. And that involves a radical reorientation of one's total self. In other words, when we really fear God, the way the Bible describes the fear of God, you know what happens? Our ambitions begin to change. Our affections begin to change. Our actions begin to change if we truly fear God. And so it really means that we view life very differently. We look at life and we look at it with different sets of eyes, and we think, life is no longer about me. It's no longer about my ambitions. It becomes a calling because God calls us to Himself. He calls us to serve Him. He calls us to worship Him. But not as a religious duty that we have been falsely been deceived to perform only on Sundays, but to worship Him every day of our lives, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday, yes, with every breath that we've got. It's not just a Sunday thing to fear God, that just because you went to this church today, you fear God. It doesn't necessarily follow. If you truly fear God, after this church, what you do tomorrow will determine the authenticity of your fear of God. There was an Indonesian lady back near Singapore, an island near Singapore. And the Indonesian lady somehow got hold of our group and wanted to talk to me. Of course, I could not understand Bahasa. She could not understand English. And so through an interpreter, she asked for me and asked that she be baptized. And so I asked about her background, and apparently this Indonesian was Muslim before. She was married to a Christian, that's what she says. But when they got married, they retained their religious persuasions. So he was Christian, she was Muslim. They had three children. All the three children became Muslims like her. The children had grandchildren, and all the grandchildren were Muslim. The husband passes away 5 years ago. And this is what happens. She called me because about 2 months ago, she had a dream. And in her dream was her husband. And the husband was carrying a cross. And the husband walked closer and closer to her and put that cross right before her face. And she heard Jesus speaking to her. And Jesus says, "Come, follow me." Immediately, she saw Jesus is real, Jesus is God, Jesus is the one I need to worship. And she accepted Jesus right there and then because of that dream. And because she was a teacher in the Muslim school, just like we have Christian school, there was a Muslim school, and she was a teacher there, she announced to the school that she was now a Christian. And so the director of the Muslim school said, "You're fired. We cannot have Muslims in this school, I mean Christians in this school." And so she was fired. She went to her three children and she announced to them, "Oh, by the way, kids, I am now a follower of Jesus. And you know what? Because of that, my children, they fired me in the school where your children go to, my grandchildren in that school. And you know what? Because they fired me, your children, my grandchildren in that school will no longer receive the subsidies they used to receive when I was teaching. And her children got so angry at her and they dismissed her and said, "You are no longer our mother." And so she's by herself. She knocked on the door of the neighboring church, neighbor of the Muslim school, knocked on the door and said, "Pastor," and the pastor was there, "Pastor, can you please baptize me? Because I am now a follower of Jesus." And the pastor said, "I know you. Aren't you from this school?" "Yes, Pastor, but I am now a follower of Jesus." "Well, wait a minute. This is dangerous. This is risky if you come to this church. I cannot baptize you." She knocks on another church, another church, another church. The same answer: "We cannot baptize you because it's just too risky. What would people say? This church might be in jeopardy. Our safety, our security might be at risk. We cannot do that." In fact, one church, one pastor said, "Okay, we're going to do it. One condition: you show us your ID that now has the word Christian instead of Muslim, because there they actually put in your ID what religion you are." Of course she cannot get that, because if she does, she's going to be persecuted, she's going to be interrogated. It's going to be very difficult to change her ID from Muslim to Christian. And so what does she do? She finds out about this lunatic named Caloy Peña from Singapore. And so we were talking, "Can you baptize me, Pastor?" And I said, "Of course. One condition: we go to GCF." "No." "We go to Singapore." "No. No conditions. I'm going to come. I ride a ferry to the island." And in my mind, "Lord, may that place where I will baptize her be so secure, so private, that nobody witnesses her baptism." It's so opposite to what baptisms are, isn't it? I mean, a baptism is a public declaration of your faith in Jesus, isn't it? But that was my prayer, because I was scared as well. At any rate, it was okay. We had a service. There were people around. They were watching. She was baptized. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And then I gave her a gift, and the gift was a Bible. Wasn't in English. She didn't know English. It wasn't even in Bahasa, Indonesia, the national language, because her heart language was Batak. And that was the Bible that I found for her. For the first time in her life, she saw the very words of God in her own language, and she was full of tears. You know, when we fear God, it's radical. You understand the consequences of making a decision to trust in Jesus. And so the prayer continues on. As she was crying after the baptism, she was actually praising God for what had happened. Just like the psalmist, verse 3, "May the peoples praise you, God. May all the peoples praise you. May the nations be glad and sing for joy, for you rule the peoples with equity and guide the nations on the earth." And then once again, that chorus, "May the peoples praise you, God. May all the peoples praise you." Three things. Who are the makers of praise? The Hebrew words, people and the nations, these are interchangeable. But generally speaking, peoples would refer to Israel and the nations around Israel. And so what I did was, what does that Hebrew word nation, how is it translated in Greek? There is the Septuagint, which is the Greek version of the Hebrew Bible written in 200 BC. And so I looked at that version, and the word for nations is the same word in Matthew 28, ethne, ethnos, where we get the word ethnic groups, tribal groups. And so what do we have here? We have these peoples and nations giving praise to God, rejoicing in God, singing for joy. They are ethnic peoples. They are distinct by color. They're distinct by language, distinct by culture, but they're all united in making praise to God. They're not segregated. They're all together giving praise to God. And when you look at the movements of praise, they were praising, they were rejoicing, they were singing for joy. That's a movement from simply praising, where they lift their hands, literally, to God in celebration. That's what it means to praise. You cannot praise without lifting the hands. Literally, that's what it means. Lift your hands toward God in celebration. It's like if you're a Cleveland Cavalier fan. How many of you are Cavs fan? Never mind, because I'm Warriors. Just kidding. I'm a Lakers fan, so never mind. Remember LeBron James blocking that layup by Iguodala? And then suddenly Kyrie Irving hitting that three-point shot like a dagger in the heart of Warriors fans? Last few seconds? And suddenly, oh my goodness, my heart broke. But the Cleveland fans were praising. They were lifting their hands in celebration. That's what it means to praise God. Lift your hands in victory, in celebration. They were making noise. To be glad is to rejoice. And they were singing for joy. Why? Oh no, we're not talking basketball. They were singing for joy. They were praising so loudly because, it says, you rule your people with equity. What does that mean? How does that even cause me to praise God? You rule with equity? Well, every people, nation, language, and tribe shouts in happiness at God's justice. You see, he rules without tyranny. He rules without partiality. In other words, he's more than just an NBA replay center. You know what I mean? He's more than just a Hawkeye technology when you love tennis in Wimbledon, for example. And the player says, I question that call by the umpire, and then there's this technology, right? And you hear the people clap because it's slow motion, and it'll show whether the ball actually hits the line or is outside the line, and then it becomes the rule. It becomes the call. It is like if you like football, and early tomorrow morning, it's going to be, who's playing? Germany. No, not Germany. Never mind. The goal line technology in football, you remember that one? Sometimes the ball, you're not sure whether it really gets into the net, or is it halfway through, or is the whole ball inside, or what is it? And there's a goal line technology that determines whether it's in or out. And so you have all these technologies that makes the wrong right. And guess what? Brothers and sisters, have you experienced any injustice in your life? Are you a victim of injustice? Here's what we learn. They don't go unnoticed in heaven. Time will come when you think that you've lost because of a bum call by the referee in this life. Heaven actually sees everything, and it's going to correct every wrong made here on earth, because in heaven is a replay center, and God's eye is always right and is razor sharp. And therefore, that buzzer beater, three-point shot that was nullified by the refs in heaven, it's actually counted. It was before the buzzer, and therefore we win. And therefore we praise God because he is just. There are wrong calls in this life, and it happens all the time to you and me. Wrong calls, and we are victims. But in heaven, everything will be made right. Therefore, the peoples all over the world who know Jesus Christ, they actually exclaim, they proclaim, and they praise God because this God knows everything and he puts every wrong right. Hallelujah. And here it says, not only does he rule with equity, he guides the nations. You know that word guide? It's the same word in Psalm 23, verse 3. He leads us beside still waters. It's the same word. In other words, this God who is so just is also a God who is so loving. He rules the world with justice, and He is a loving shepherd. What a combination, isn't it? Nothing is more ecstatic than to see your team win a championship. It's the same raw emotion when all peoples of the world encounter His just rule and loving lead. Now, may I say this, brothers and sisters? This multicultural, multilingual event that the Bible talks about, it's been foreshadowed at Pentecost. You remember Pentecost? You remember the story in Pentecost when the disciples of Jesus Christ were in the upper room, and then the Holy Spirit fell upon them, and they began to speak in different languages, and those around them began to hear natives of other places in the land. They heard their own language being spoken by these Jews, and they were Galileans. I said, how did that happen? How did they know our language? In other words, you see, Pentecost foreshadowed this multicultural event. John, the Apostle John, as he was exiled in the island of Patmos, actually saw this heavenly vision as well, where every tribe, every nation, every tongue, every people are giving praise to the Lamb that was slain. And so what do we see? The birth of the church, Pentecost. The start of the church, Pentecost, multicultural, multilingual, multiracial, multiethnic, past. You go to the future in heaven, we're all praising God, every tongue, every tribe, every nation, every people, together, multi. That's the end of the church. Here's the beginning of the church, and in between is the church, and the church is segregated. When at Pentecost, it wasn't. In heaven, it isn't. And when you go down here on earth, what has happened? Where is everybody? Why are we all the same? Isn't it? We can do much better than that. Much, much better. Not only when there's big global Christian conferences somewhere in Korea and all the pastors in the world go to Korea and they sing how great is our God in many languages. It happens there, but it should happen here. And you might say, Pastor, you're crazy. Because here, we're all Filipino. Exactly. But it need not be all Filipino. In fact, it need not be all Tagalog. Some of you actually are not Tagalog. Some of you are Bisaya. Some of you are Ilonggo. Right? I think the time should come when we need to learn how to worship with some people who are just not like us. Because if you are not able to do that now, you are not going to enjoy heaven, because that's what it's going to be. Let me tell you a story. In our small gathering at homes, we had somebody come, a Jehovah's Witness guy. He came, and then we understood he was hearing impaired. He could not hear, and therefore he could not speak as well. And we began to try to learn a little bit of sign language. We tried to type on the iPad or laptop so he can at least see what we're trying to say. And then suddenly we had a man from Brunei who also joined our group, and he was an expert. In fact, his burden actually were people who were hearing impaired. And so perfect, you know, he began to do all the sign languages for us, for this man. And then we had a family day where we invited the man's network of friends who were all deaf-mute, and we all tried to learn sign language so we can introduce ourselves, we can say a little bit about ourselves, we can tell them where is the CR, you know, things like that, necessary things in sign language. And guess what? Then we had an American family come, and this couple had a son, an American, but they could no longer have any children. And they were praying, Lord, we really like to have more children. Would you bless us with more children? Of course, they were asking God for a miracle, but that wouldn't happen until finally they said, maybe it's time to adopt. And so they adopted a North Korean boy. And then when they came to Singapore, we were all together. Their burden was to ask God whether he would still bless them and ask God whether they should adopt more. And they had a phone call suddenly from the hospital in Singapore and said, do you want a son? Do you want a baby? There is this teenager who's about to give birth. She's deciding whether to stop the delivery or if there's somebody who likes this boy, she will give it away. And they simply said, we will have the boy. And so now they have an American son, they have a North Korean son, and now they have a Singaporean son. And they continue to pray, Lord, bless us. Give us more. As they were praying for more, we had another family come. This time, he was from mainland China. She was from Taiwan, married. No, some would say, that's impossible. China and Taiwan? Yeah, it is possible. And they had a daughter. But they could not have any more children as well. And so they were also asking, God, would you like us to have more children? The husband says, I don't like to have more children. One is fine. Right? He's really from mainland China. One is fine. But the wife wanted more. And so they prayed. And as they saw this American family, with an American child, a North Korean child, a Singaporean child, they began to talk to each other, pray for one another, until finally the heart of this Chinese husband was ready for adoption. Meanwhile, the American family were looking forward to another adoption from China this time. Remember, they had an American, they had a Korean, they had a Singaporean, and now they were waiting for the fourth from China. They had a phone call, and they said, it's going to take a long time to find a son for you in China. Maybe you like a daughter? And they said, no, a son. We'll wait. Well, suddenly, a phone call again. There is a boy. Are you ready? Nobody wants this boy. And they said, well, what's the problem with the boy? The problem is he is hearing impaired. Now, before that, it is also this American family that suddenly had a burden for the hearing impaired in our group. They actually learned sign language. I only learned basic. They learned diehard sign language, and they really loved it. And guess what? Now, there is this child, deaf-mute. And they said, thank you, Lord. This is it. Can you imagine? Having an American, North Korean, Singaporean, Chinese. And I said, would you like to adopt me, a Filipino? I mean, I'm old, but I'm still adoptable. You know what I'm saying? Anyway. So, this Chinese couple, you know, Chinese and Taiwanese with a daughter, they also went to the same orphanage and say, we like a boy. No, they said, we like either. And so there was a call. No boy. We have a girl. Would you like a girl? Yes. Well, nobody likes this girl. I say, why? Because this girl is an albino. She's got blonde hair, but she's an albino. And guess what? The husband says to God, God, you've got a sense of humor, don't you? You know why? When this man was a lad in high school, he got bullied by an albino. And so he says, I hate albinos. I remember my past too painful to remember. So they prayed, God, is this your will for us? They prayed and prayed. They prayed together with the other American family, encouraged one another until finally they said, yes, we're going to have an albino daughter. They went to Beijing. Before they got the child, the albino child, he looked for the albino bully when they were in high school. And he looked at him and he found him and they talked. And he said, you are the curse of my life. But guess what? God is reversing the curse. Because now we're going to adopt someone who looks like you, but is going to be part of my family to be loved. To be loved. When they brought the child to Singapore, my goodness, all these kids, you say, wow. We say, wow. And we're giving thanks to God, all these different languages, all these different people. And say, I don't, you know, it's never comfortable because it's not natural for me. And I'd rather sing, I'd rather praise God even in Tagalog, but I couldn't do that. I have to somehow accommodate myself to them all the time. And I never enjoy my own worship with God because I always have to consider them. And that is what church is. We wait for one another. We are a one another church. We are in relationship with one another. And together with all our differences, we give praise to God. Not because it's convenient, but because God does marvelous things beyond what we can imagine. And when he does miracles in our lives, there is no other thing but to give praise to him. All nations, all peoples, all tongues. Question for you, question for me is, so, Pastor, what is the blessing? Now, you're talking about the Old Testament book. We are New Testament Christians. So what is the blessing we in the New Testament days actually pray for? Do we still pray today for abundance, material? That's a good question, isn't it? You want to know the answer. I believe that the prayer of Psalm 67 has been answered. God has given the blessing. But it's only partially fulfilled. Because when he gave the blessing, from that blessing, all the nations of the earth got blessed. You know what I'm saying? It's Jesus who is the blessing, and through Jesus, all the nations have been blessed. That's why you and I are here. It's because of Jesus. You see, when God promised Abraham, I'm going to bless you and you're going to be a blessing, it's going to be through Abraham, through Isaac, through Jacob, through Judah, and from Judah to King David. And then God says to David, David, your throne, your kingdom will be forever. Forever. In other words, David, somebody, you're going to be a dynasty, and your kingdom will be eternal. And it is from David that Jesus is born. He is the Messiah. He is the predicted Son of God who would be the blessing, and that through him, all the nations of the earth will be blessed. But it's partial. Because he came, lived on this earth, proved that he is indeed the Son of God through his death, burial, and resurrection. He went back to heaven. And so he is not here today, but he is coming back. When he comes back, the blessing will be fulfilled 100-fold fully for us. And so here it is. We have received the blessing in Jesus Christ partially. He's coming back soon. And so the prayer in this psalm answered through Jesus, the challenge for us as followers of Jesus is try to apply it in our lives today in the light of Jesus. He is the blessing. We've received the blessing. How do we become a blessing to the nations? How do we do that? That is a huge challenge before us. It has challenged my faith in the last 5 years, and I pass on the same challenge to you. It is a call to the modern church to live in three dimensions of life, and here are some of those lessons. First, it is a challenge to live vocationally. What do I mean by that? You see, there is no getting around it. To pray for personal blessings is actually to say, Lord, I am positioning myself so that the nations will know. It's one and the same. Lord, bless me. Lord, I ask for your superabundance in my life But God will hear that prosperity prayer only if in your heart you're also praying, God, I am positioning myself because the nations need to hear. The nations need to know. And when that is your prayer, God's going to bless you. God's going to bless you. In other words, the faithful life is a vocational life. In other words, your careers, your employments, your professions, whatever it is you do in life in order to somehow receive some blessing in life, they are not to be hoarded. They are not to be put in investments so that you can live in cul-de-sacs where it is a dead end and you simply prosper in that dead end. You should be living in crossroads so that as you are promoted, as God gives you more and more, you're able to shovel back more and more, and more peoples of the world will get to know that Jesus Christ is indeed the Savior and Lord that God has sent. So, careers ought to be looked upon very differently, radically differently. You see, it's a calling to be blessed. Yes, of course, but in order to be a blessing. Did you get that? We can pray for an audacious prayer and say, God bless me. But in order to give to GCF Ozamis, some of you are going to ask, God bless me. In fact, some of you are probably being called by God. You not only give to Ozamis, you go set up your business in Ozamis. Bless the people in Ozamis. Boy, I love this thing when I'm not a member of this church. It's to tell you to give. Go. Isn't it? It's vocational. There's no such thing as spiritual life, church life, business life. There's no such thing in God's economy. So instead of cul-de-sacs where our prosperity gets clogged up, we keep upgrading with the rest of our neighbors. Our employment ought to be the crossroads between our personal sufficiency and the bankruptcy of the world. Crossroads. So it's a call to live your life vocationally. That's the implication of Psalm 67. Secondly, it is actually a challenge to link cross-culturally. Do you get the point? Don't simply be with people of the same. Our intentional discipleship program somehow has ignored something really crucial in that Great Commission. Make disciples, yes. Make disciples and make disciples and make disciples, yes. But it says of all nations. It doesn't say make disciples of the same nation all the time. Make disciples of all nations. And therefore, our focus needs to be sharpened, isn't it? Yes, we want more people getting to know the Lord, being saved by God. But you know what? The Bible is very clear. It's not necessarily only more of the same kind of people, but more of the different kinds of people. And therefore, while there are plenty of Filipino churches all around this planet, and in every country, there is a Filipino church. But if you visit those churches, you know what you see? All Filipinos. In other words, the light of Jesus, while it shines, we put a blanket on that light and let it shine only among us Filipinos, among us only Tagalogs, among us only Ilonggos. I mean, it's incredible. I went to a church, Filipino church in Chicago. They met in the J.P. Rizal Center in downtown Chicago. So I go over there, and guess what? I was surprised. I thought there was only one church. There's four churches, all Filipino. All different denominations. Guess what? One was Tagalog, one was Bisaya, one was Ilonggo, the other I forget. But they're all separated from one another. You know what? You might say, Pastor, you are out of your mind. Dito, here in Ortigas, there's no foreigner, really. I mean, there's no non-Tagalog people here, really. I mean, how long you live in condominiums here? I mean, even in your condominiums, there are other people. I mean, you have a neighbor here in ADB. Oh, my goodness, there's a lot of non-Filipinos over there. So don't tell me that you don't have them here. They're all over the place if you only open your eyes. Link. I'm not even dare to say live cross-culturally because that is scary. You want to go to Africa? You want to go to Cambodia? You want to go to all these places? Yes, you do. Yes, you may. And my challenge to you is simply link. Link cross-culturally with others. John Piper said, the task of missions may not be merely to win as many individuals as possible from the most responsive peoples in the world, but the task of missions is to win every individual, an individual in every ethnic group of the world. That is the task of missions. Finally, what's the challenge? We can do this. I mean, we are the happiest people in the world, aren't we? It is a call to live joyfully. I don't need to press that point, isn't it? I mean, actually, if you live in Singapore, you know who's the Pinoy. Always talks, loud, always smiling, always happy. I mean, I love Filipinos. I truly do, because there's this extrovertness and joy, seemingly, that's part of the makeup of every Filipino. But let's get back. Praise and joy are God's tests of genuine spirituality. Praise and joy, they are proofs that we are genuine. Because if this is not so, then there isn't real much change in our lives. If the president would say real change, he would say, tinud-anay nga kabag-uhan. I heard that in his speech. Yeah? 10 lepers were healed, only one returned to give glory to God. The world is so full of murmurers. The world is so full of complainers. How few abound in hearty, thankful praise. You know, when we like just being with the same, guess what? You're going to have problems. You're going to have lots of complaints, lots of critiques, because you're all the same, and you wonder, why are we all the same? And I want to be different, and so you're going to look at yourselves, but if there's so many differences around you, guess what? Less murmuring, less complainers. How few truly abound in thankful praise. Think about it. The power of sin is destroyed in our lives. Guilt, pardon, the emptiness of our souls, they're now filled. The infection from all sin is now cleansed. And so there's this spiritual surgery that has happened in our lives. And that surgery somehow must produce a different kind of person who is so happy, is the happiest people in the face of the earth. Because God has done something incredible in our lives. So let me end with a personal story. You know, I came from in high school and a little bit of grade school from all-boys school. Then I entered University of the Philippines in college, and suddenly it was no longer all-boys. And suddenly I felt like the macho-ness in me got diminished. And so I said, to retain my macho-ness, I got to be part of a fraternity. Got to sign up. In fact, I not only signed up, I got scheduled for hazing in order to be a part of a fraternity. I mean, that's being a real man. But as I was waiting for my time to be initiated into the fraternity, there were these people who were stalking me where I moved from classroom to classroom, and they had this little booklet called The Four Spiritual Laws. You know that? Four Spiritual Laws? And I told myself, who are these guys? I mean, they are religious fanatics. They're not real men. But I said, in order to get rid of them, easy. Just let them share it to you. Right? And so they did. So I listened. I said, yes. Yes. Yes, that's a nice verse. Yes, that's true. Yes, that's true. Yes, I'm going to pray the sinner's prayer. And I did, because I thought, that's right. That's right. That's right. And I did. And then I said, can you now leave me alone? They didn't. As I looked at them, I said, these guys are baduy and bakya. Now, some of you young people don't know what those words mean. The modern word is hashtag baduy. Hashtag bakya. I don't know what the modern words are, but I told myself, who wants to be like that? I mean, it isn't cool. It isn't macho. Suddenly become religious? What's that? That's not a real man. And then suddenly I saw a little bit of joy in these men. these people are happy. And at first I was laughing at their happiness. And then their happiness, instead of laughing, I began to think about their joy. There's something to this. I wonder what it is. And as I tried to figure it out and look at the sincerity of their joy, from laughter, ridicule, to thinking and reflecting, I said to myself, I want that joy. That is the challenge for you and me, is to live a distinctly qualitative life where the joy of the Lord beams through us. Sheldon Vanocken, in his book, Severe Mercy, had this to say: the best argument for Christianity is Christians. Their joy, their certainty, their completeness. The strongest argument against Christianity is also Christians, when they're somber and joyless, when they're self-righteous and smug and complacent in consecration, when they're narrow and repressive, then Christianity dies a thousand deaths. Brothers and sisters, missions calls forth these three lifestyle qualities. And it is deeply dependent on God, not on ourselves, because it happens only in answer to prayer. And so let's pray, God bless us, but remember why we pray for blessings. It is to be a blessing to the nations. Psalm 67 ends with like a benediction. May God bless us still, so that all the ends of the earth will fear him. The journey began with prayer. It ends with prayer. And that's worship for us in full circle. But there is the final prayer, but it's also a challenge for you and me. Because as the worship leader would pronounce, may God bless us still, he says, the service is over. God bless you. But as you go out of these doors into the world, remember, you are blessed so that all the ends of the earth may fear him. In other words, John Piper says, and I'll close with this, the test of the authenticity of our Sunday worship is our Monday work. God bless you. May he bless you still, so that all the ends of the earth may fear him. So when you go out of these doors, you begin Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, say, God bless me, so that I may be a worker for you all the days of my life, and others, all the nations of the earth, will bow before you, because you are the King of kings and the Lord of lords. So let's pray. Father, we thank you so much for your word. Sometimes so simple to pray these prayers and yet so profound. Help us, Lord, to apply these principles, no matter how hard it may be, to show that our hearts are predisposed to doing your will, and therefore we can have the audacity to ask you for all your blessings. Yes, Lord, bless us. Yes, Lord, with abundance. Yes, Lord, with things that we can not even imagine we can ever have in this life. But as we pray that prayer, Lord, we're positioning ourselves so that others may hear the good news about Jesus Christ. Thank you, Lord, for GCF. Thank you for each one here tonight, for blessing them. We give you praise. We give you honor. In Jesus' name, amen. Would you all rise with me as we receive the Lord's benediction, and we will be dismissed after receiving the Lord's benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious. The Lord lift his countenance upon you and give you peace. And so now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, prayed for by a pastor or a church leader, the loving rule of our Heavenly Father, and the sweet fellowship of the Spirit of God be upon you to bless you. And a
pastor, or
so that all the ends of the earth
you and pray for
may
you.
Fear him.
Thank you for letting
amen.
Us serve you.
And amen. The Lord bless you. The service is over.